You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning, afternoon, evening, whatever it is. Couple of administrivia things today before we start the lecture. One you may have noticed or not, that I extended the deadline for reaction paper 3. There was a tiny glitch that a few people had close to the midnight or 11:59 deadline. So it was just affected a few people, but I decided to keep it back open for everybody. I've looked through a few of the answers, a few of the things, and they're fascinating. Interesting to watch what you guys do when you're studying and watching lectures. It's very informative. A couple other administrative things. We're going to be talking about technology and aggression today, and particularly video gaming. And my guess is that today's lecture will overlap heavily into Thursday. Then the week following is our spring break. Yay! Everybody gets a week off. I'm going to visit my daughter and son-in-law in Denver. And catching a Dodger baseball game at Coors Field. How exciting. I'm a diehard Dodger fan, so the idea that the Dodgers are in town playing at Coors Field is really fun, so I get to do that while I'm there. Then the week we come back, which would be the, let's see, what date is that? Calendar in my head. George is gonna help me here with a calendar. So what's the Tuesday there?
Ninth.
Okay, so the 9th is a review session for the second exam. The second exam is on Thursday the 11th. Again, opening at 7 a.m., closing at 11:59 p.m. that day. We will not have any other interruptions, hopefully with Blackboard, and everything will go smoothly. I'll talk more about that as time goes on. I'm working on the study guide. My guess is the study guide will be out this week as I judge how much of the lecture I get done today and decide how much I'm gonna talk about on Thursday. Then I'll put together the final study guide, so it'll probably be out by Thursday, I hope. Maybe even by Wednesday, by tomorrow. I'm about two-thirds done with it, three-quarters done maybe. Do remember that the next exam covers material from the lecture, material from the PowerPoints, material from the book, and just so you know, when I'm making up exam questions, I rewatch every video that I show, because we see a lot of videos in this class. I rewatch every video and try to ask questions from the videos also, to make sure that you are paying attention. I don't just stick the videos in there willy-nilly. Oh, that's a funny word. But I stick them in there because they contain important information. So do make sure that you watch them if you're not watching this live. Do make sure that you watch the videos, particularly if you watch on YouTube. There's a link to every single video there. I think that may be it for the administrivia stuff. George and I are going to start grading papers after midnight tonight, not 12:01, but we will start grading papers, and I suspect it'll take us a few days to go through 400 papers for reaction paper 3. I have no idea when they'll be done. Please don't ask, because I won't tell you, and don't beg, because I won't tell you. So with that in mind, if there is anybody out there that has questions, I don't know if anybody watches this live anymore. We were just talking about that before the class, that perhaps out of the 400, there are, what George says, there's 6 people now watching live. Thank you so much. You should say hi and ask questions during the lecture. It would make me feel better that I'm not just talking to a hedgehog on top of the camera. So let's go to the screen and let's talk about aggression and technology. So first of all, there's a long history of this concept of mass murder, which you'll read about in the book, and video gaming. And oftentimes when school shootings happen, and particularly know because when Columbine school shooting was not the first one, but it was the first one that really brought to mind people's idea that there's some relationship between violent video games and mass shootings. That was because the two guys who shot up Columbine School were gamers. They played Doom and Quake, which were two pretty interesting shooting games. And we're going to talk a lot about that and some theories behind that and why that might happen. The interesting thing, and I don't, there's a little short video about the Columbine shooting, because I suspect that many of you weren't even born when Columbine happened, or you were a child, so you may not even remember it, but I certainly remember it, and remember the kind of fallout after it, which basically they kind of went into these kids who did this and found that not only did they play these video games, but they sort of had weird musical tastes, very heavy metal, kind of death metal stuff. But they were also into computers a lot. And so this really started the whole concept of mass murders and violent video games. So now you're going to watch a video about Columbine.
Again today, suddenly and with a vengeance. Columbine High in Littleton, Colorado, it has been a horror.
In 1999, two high school students went on a deadly rampage, and the images seared themselves into the nation's collective memory.
One of the worst school shootings ever, 15 dead bodies still being identified.
An American nightmare that too many schools know too well.
Yet how much of our explanation for that nightmare was right?
The entire country was confident that these two killers were two loner outcasts from the Trenchcoat Mafia who were targeting jocks in a revenge fantasy. None of that was true.
Misguided perceptions of the Columbine shooting continue to influence us today.
On April 20th, 1999, two students culminated months of planning by donning black trench coats and attacking their school. Armed with guns and an arsenal of homemade bombs, they terrorized teachers and peers.
They had a couple of duffel bags at their feet, and we witnessed them pulling out what we assumed to be paintball guns that later on turned out to be something completely different.
My secretary comes in and yells that there had been a report of gunfire and bombs exploding. So I ran out of my office, saw a gunman coming towards me. I remember hearing gunfire, and I remember glass breaking behind me.
I was laying in broken glass from the window that had gotten shot out. All I could hear was the fire alarms going off. And then the gunshots at a distance.
Okay, has anybody been injured?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. And the school is in a panic, and I'm in the library. I've got students down under the tables, kids! Heads under the tables!
We were all crouched under the tables, and we could hear the gunshots getting louder, and a couple times there was a big boom, and the floor would shake.
On the floor! You better stay on the floor!
Oh, God! Stay in the line of
the... Oh, God!
They came into the library. Eric leaned under the table and pointed his gun at me. I mean, I was like trembling under there like a little leaf.
I saw the shotgun, stared at the shotgun, and all I remember is it seemed like the barrel of the gun was the size of a cannon.
As soon as that bullet entered my backpack and actually paralyzed me, shattering my vertebrae, that's when the pain set in.
So there was like Eric on my right, and then Dylan was up on my left. And I looked up at Dylan and I said, "Hey, Dylan." And he said, "Hey, man." And I said, "What are you doing?" And it still like chills me how he was just like, killing people.
The killers fatally shot 12 students and a teacher in less than 20 minutes. Then they turned the guns on themselves.
12 kids died on my watch, along with the teacher. In our lives, you're not supposed to bury your kids, and they were all my kids.
Before the world had fully grasped what had happened inside the school, there was a scramble to make sense of it.
We're getting coverage from four stations in the Denver area of a shooting at a high school.
A still developing situation, and one that looks like it's not going to be over anytime soon.
Horrors like Columbine terrify us, and we need an explanation. So even if we don't have an answer, we find one. And we find it really too fast.
Two witnesses that we talked to on the telephone describe them as members of the trench coat mafia. These are kids they claim routinely dress in black trench coats.
Kids were watching this on TV. And also, it was the early days of cell phones. If they weren't seeing it, their friends were watching it on TV, calling them on their cell phones and letting them know.
They were saying that that they wanted to do this for their revenge for the school, I guess, because, I mean, they're such an outcast at our school.
Was this a little round and round feedback chamber? So when a kid goes on TV and says, oh yeah, they were outcasts, another kid who doesn't really know the killers well or at all thinks, oh, they're outcasts. Oh, I didn't realize that. Then when he's interviewed, he says they're outcasts. So you're contaminating the witness pool like that.
And speculation about a black-coated mafia and its supposed grievances ran wild.
A gang that apparently hated athletes.
It was all because people were mean to him last year.
The trench coat mafia is more than just black clothes. These boys were dangerously strange.
In a yearbook photo of some group members that was broadcast nationwide, neither gunman appeared. One member of the Trenchcoat Mafia, John Savage, said there was a good reason for their absence.
Eric and Dylan were not at all a part of the things that we did as a group. They didn't hang out with us. They weren't Trenchcoat Mafia at all.
And he says the media's description of him and his friends had little basis in fact.
The Trenchcoat Mafia was like, we were video game nerds. We sit around the table and, you know, play Dungeons and Dragons, you know, which is just about the least dangerous thing you could do.
It was a group of friends that had similar interests. Some kids referred to them as the Trenchcoat Mafia, but it was not that it was an organized club.
But the explanation about outcast loners seeking revenge against bullies had the dual advantage of being both dramatic and familiar.
What happened here at Littleton is a grotesque distortion of high school fears and rivalries involving cliques, the in-groups and out-groups that are a part of teen life in America.
Author Dave Cullen spent nearly 10 years on his account of Columbine, researching police records, the killers' diaries, and their lives at the school. He said the boys had busy social lives and didn't seem motivated by bullying.
There was lots of bullying at Columbine. It was a high school in America. Did it have anything to do with driving these two boys to murder? I cannot find any evidence of that.
The killers directed their hostility toward the whole student population, placing propane bombs set to go off in the cafeteria at lunchtime. But the devices failed to detonate as planned.
Columbine actually wasn't a successful shooting. It was a failed bombing. How much more indiscriminate can you get? Two big bombs to kill everyone who happens to be in that part of the building at the start of a lunch.
Cullen describes the killers' motives as a cocktail of malice, self-loathing, and a craving for fame. Over time, they became something like a two-man cult, bent on making their mark on the world in one final act.
It was a murder-suicide for both of them. For Eric, it was primarily a murder. For Dylan, it was primarily suicide. They took the tactics of terrorists, said, we can do the same stuff for our own aggrandizement. Eric talked about his audience in his journal and whether they were going to understand this.
And there was one message observers seemed to take from the event immediately.
School shootings have become a dark stain on American life.
The phenomenon of kids turning guns on their schoolmates is all too familiar.
And it's not just Littleton. We know that now. We've had lots and lots and lots of places.
Columbine came after a string of school shootings in Oregon, Arkansas, and other states. Reaction to the Colorado massacre helped fuel a national movement towards school security.
Parents across the country are demanding to know what their schools are doing to keep their children safe.
Today, nearly half of public schools surveyed nationwide employ police or hired guards, At least 21 states mandate lockdown drills for school shooting scenarios, and millions of dollars have been spent on everything from metal detectors to anti-bullying programs.
When people hear that somebody was caught planning a Columbine, the world knows what that means.
More than a decade after Columbine, we're still struggling to figure out not only what causes school shootings, but whether or not we're seeing more of them. And coverage of the issue offers little clarity.
School shootings are on the rise in America. I'm telling you, I have the numbers to show it.
But there's actually very little consensus on those numbers.
Experts say that the number is statistically unchanged since the 1990s.
The number of school shootings in America has been rapidly in decline over the last decade.
Researchers can't agree on a methodology for tallying up attacks. They make different decisions about whether to include non-fatal attacks on schools or foiled ones, or even on-campus suicides or gun accidents. And this leads to vastly different final numbers.
We unfortunately tend to judge how frequently events occur by how often we hear about them. And that, of course, depends on news reports of these things happening.
The death toll rises in an attack inside a school cafeteria.
In Los Angeles, two students were wounded in an accidental shooting. A school shooting in Texas leaves two students injured.
One statistic with a more clear-cut definition is overall homicides in schools. The Center for Disease Control regularly tracks those numbers. And the trend line is clear. While they vary from year to year, school homicides are essentially flat across the decades. They're also extremely rare.
There are over 300 shootings every day in the United States. How many of those occur in schools? Almost none of them.
And rare as they are, when school shootings do happen, there's some evidence that past attacks and intense media focus on the killers have helped inspire future ones.
Song Hee Cho wrote that he was inspired by the Columbine killer's attack 8 years ago today.
The gunman, Adam Lanza, was obsessed with the 1999 Columbine High School attack.
And some news outlets are beginning to take notice.
We are not, during this broadcast, using the name of the shooter. Often it seems that history remembers the names of murderers and not the names of victims.
Good that school shootings are still shocking because it shows that they're really rare. So I think it's important to kind of keep in mind that there are a lot of schools all over the world where no one's ever been shot.
I could spend my entire life living in fear, wondering when's the next attack or when's the next person going to do that, but that would be it. I'd be living in fear. I would be giving in to what they wanted to happen.
So the Columbine shooting was important for a lot of reasons. I wanted to give you that video so that you could get a sense of all of the ways that people thought might have contributed to the two kids shooting up the school. And wanted to point out that really this spawned a tremendous amount of research. And primarily the research was looking at mass murders. And there's a whole branch of research out there on mass murders. But what I'm particularly focusing on are mass murders that have some ties to video gaming. Because as I mentioned, the two killers played violent video games. So people were making this kind of natural link between playing violent video games and shootings or mass murders. So let's go back and just first look at mass murders. And in general, we've seen tons of these, sadly. And now what you see, unlike Columbine, where it was sort of intimated that the shooters were violent video gamers, now they talk about it ad nauseum, and both of the Newtown and Aurora shootings had regularly played first-person shooting games. But then as you'll see through that throughout today and Thursday, that there's millions of people who play those kind of games and don't commit crimes. So how do you decide causality? And a lot of what we talk about in here is research to decide causality. And as you'll see from this research as a precursor to this series of lectures, you'll see that there really is sort of a confusion about the order of causality. And we'll talk more about that as we talk about the model, a model of aggression, and as we talk about some of the research that's been done. The Sandy Hook shooting, by the way, because Adam Lanza preferred to play nonviolent games, the investigators in that one never linked violent video gaming to the shootings, whereas in all of the others, in general, they find that the shooters play violent video games. So just to give you some statistics, mass shooters tend to be obsessed with former mass shootings, which you just saw in the video. They seem to be obsessed with getting some sort of fame and popularity. You heard Anderson Cooper say that CNN will not say the names of the shooters in order to not make them seem bigger and more popular than they should be. Almost all mass murderers are males. I think that's important. In fact, I can't even remember any kind of shooting where a female was involved in a school shooting. The majority are white, which is also interesting. And usually we think of the mass murders or mass shooters as being young people, but in general they tend, outside of the school environment where school students are doing the shooting, they tend to be in their 30s, maybe even in their 40s. And Kerry said back in 2013, and I think it's very valid to say this, that they're just too rare to be studied in any kind of rigorous way. So let's take a look at another view, a little more stringent view from Fox News about how Laura Ingraham sees mass shootings.
President Trump hosted a meeting with video game makers and their critics at the White House today. He was busy. They're looking for ways to reduce youth violence following the Florida school shooting. And the president recently expressed shock at what young people are exposed to today.
The video games, the movies, the internet stuff is so violent. It's so incredible. I see it. I get to see things that you'd be amazed at. I have a young, very young son who I look at some of the things he's watching and I say, how is that possible? And this is what kids are watching.
Now let's discuss whether there is any link between violence on the screen and real violence with Ben Shapiro, editor-in-chief of The Daily Wire, and retired Army Lieutenant Colonel David Grossman, who's authored books on the psychology of violence, Army Ranger, Black Belt, and everything. Okay, you win just on that score. It's great to have you both on. Let's start with you, David, because some of these games are really wild. I mean, they're pretty graphic, pretty gory. You know them, you know, Call of Duty. I don't do any of these, but...
What, Grand Theft Auto?
Yeah, they're simulated. Simulated
it's a,
violence.
It's a criminal simulator, a murder simulator.
Yeah, Evan Ramsey, others like, you know, some of these other killers, Dylan Klebold, Eric Harris of Columbine, were steeped in these games, Adam Lanza.
The Norway killer trained on those. He said he trained on them. 69 dead on an island in Norway, and he spent a year training on video games to prepare himself for his crime. The killer at... In Florida, he spent 15 hours a day on violent video games. The most all-consuming, all-pervasive thing in this guy's life are these violent video games. And less than a year ago, the American Psychological Association made a definitive statement. There is a clear, unequivocal link between violent video games, violent behavior. Their blood pressure goes up, their heart rate goes up, violent actions go up. The data is persistent and clear across many different forms. You cannot deny it. It is overwhelming.
Ben Shapiro, I know you're skeptical about a link from video games.
Yes.
Millions and millions of people play these video games. I mean, girls aren't as into these video games, I'm sorry, as boys are, but I think if my sons had access to them, I'm sure they'd play them all the time, because something about the boys' brain and these games. But why are you not worried about it?
Well, I mean, I'm not supremely worried about it just because the consumption of these violent video games has been going up continuously since the early 90s, and yet youth violence has been going down since the early 90s. The correlation actually doesn't fit. As far as individual instances, I mean, you can find patterns in very sporadic instances among virtually all data sets, but there's some pretty mixed data about this. It's true that the American Psychological Association recommends that parents not allow their kids to play these games. I wouldn't let my kids play these games because I think they're immoral, frankly, but that should really be up to parents. I'm not sure the government should be in the business of stepping in 2011. Justice Scalia, in a majority decision, 5-4, found that it was actually unconstitutional for the state of California to regulate the capacity of parents to be able to get these video games for their kids, or even for kids to get them themselves without parental permission. You saw that as a content violation under the First Amendment.
Let's talk more about this. The assassinations that take place in the games.
You know, I my book, Laura, Assassination Generation, we outlined the dissenting opinions in that case. There's much more to this situation that we need to understand. You know, Clarence Thomas and Stephen Breyer, the most liberal, most conservative justice, mm-hmm. dissented. Stephen Breyer said they use these to train military. It's, I'm not a medical expert, but I know who is, and it's not the people the video game industry put out. You need to know more about that case. The data is so overwhelming. And when I was a kid, nobody buckled their seatbelt. We're all just fine. Not everybody with their seatbelt unbuckled died, but all the ones that died had their seatbelt.
So are you saying kids who have predispositions to this, maybe they have a trigger inside of them, they steep themselves
you add one
in this
more
violence?
Ingredient to it. A great book, Inside the Mind of a Teen Killer, the new factor in every single case, the new factor. The fact that violent crime is down is not true.
In
the last
are they using these in Army Ranger training? Do they do video simulation
no, but,
now?
But we do it with law enforcement and military training. We use simulators. You don't see it in Ranger School, but you see it as an integral part of our training. To make killing a conditioned response is part of modern training. We've got to do it. Healthy people have to be trained to kill, and the video games do the same thing to the kids.
And Ben, what I always think about this is, you know, science or not, for young children to continually see images of heads exploding, chests opening up, you talked about the immorality of all of this. Whether it's constitutional or not constitutional, maybe as a society we have to talk about what numbing ourselves to this very graphic violence. It's not like cartoon. This looks like a real person's head exploding. And it's over and over and over again. And you're doing it 10 hours a day and you're playing with people in other countries. That's where you're getting your stimulation. And that's, boys need to be outside playing, they need to be doing physical stuff. Instead, they're sitting there on these screens all day. I just don't see how any of that's good.
I fully agree with all of that. I just think there's a question of parental authority, and I think it's a question of how we as a society choose to raise our kids, not necessarily a question of governmental regulation. And the problem I have with the president getting involved is whether this is going to be a cultural issue or is this a regulatory issue? Is this an issue where the president tries to promulgate some sort of legislative response or where we're supposed to think that the government is going to step in and fix all of this? Because, again, I'm not sure that the statistics match up in terms of just public policy, but I think we're all in agreement that we'd all prefer that kids play less of this, and we have a pretty robust rating system on video games as well. I hope it gets more robust, and I hope more parents take responsibility for the crap their kids are putting in their system.
You know, the Adam Lanza, who had such an empty look in his face, he obviously had severe mental problems
We have laws protecting our kids from guns and tobacco and alcohol and pornography, sex, automobiles, firearms, and all those other areas. They wouldn't buckle their baby in their car seat if it wasn't the law. It's not yet done until we take action. Most major nations on the planet regulate children's access to these games. We're about the only major nation that doesn't do that.
Well, I'm glad I don't like these games, so it's great to have both of you on.
So, interesting discussion, right? I think one of the interesting takeaways from this, and the reason I put this on is because usually I don't like Laura Ingraham. I find that she can be very nasty, but I thought she was very even-handed here, that she let both people talk and that she got both points of view out there. And I think the really important point that Ben Shapiro made was that this shouldn't be a regulatory issue. They shouldn't regulate these, which they do, by the way, and I'll tell you about that in a second, but it should be a cultural issue. And I think what he meant by cultural issue is really a parenting issue or a family issue or a friend issue. Too often, violent video games are just too easy. I mean, I watch my grandkids, who are 5 and 6, the boys, play video games, and they've been playing these video games for probably since they were two. And they play on their tablets, and they shoot, their favorite games right now are they shoot dinosaurs, and the dinosaurs explode in blood, and the blood looks very natural. As you, those of you out there who play video games know, that somewhere in the 90s, we changed from video games that were sort of cartoonish and simulated to video games that really had a really strong realism to them. And remember when we talked about education, and I showed that curve, I don't know if you remember that, but you're going to hopefully go back and look at that lecture for the test. I showed the curve that goes, starts low with lectures, and then goes up, 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 up into video games and immersive kinds of environments like Second Life, that the more immersive it is, the more you feel present in that world, the more real it feels. And so the ratings, interesting, the ratings, the ESRB is the rating board that puts ratings. And if you play video games, you know that they're E for everyone, and I forget the ratings, but basically they go up to mature audiences, and they have age limits put on there. And I remember doing a study way back, probably in the 90s, where was part of a study of parenting that we talked about earlier. And one of the things that we did is we asked parents what their kids' favorite games were, and they wrote them down, they typed them in, or actually they wrote them down on paper. That's how bad it was back then. We were doing surveys on paper and pencil. They wrote the names of their kids' top two favorite games, and then we asked the parents, do you check the ratings of the games before you give them to the parents? And interestingly enough, when you matched the ratings of the games that the kids were playing with whether the parents actually checked the ratings, didn't fit. Those kids were playing games that were well above their age range, according to the ratings. So this is really a cultural issue and really a very important parenting issue. And I just want to keep that in mind, because that's what my takeaway from the Laura Ingraham spot was. This is really, we've tried regulating it. ESRB regulates it theoretically. Store owners are not supposed to sell video games to kids underage. Most kids don't buy them in stores anymore. They buy them online. Or they're just online gaming and they're paying for the use of it. So there's nobody in their cultural sphere who is regulating that at all. And government regulation is worthless, particularly in this case. So the regulation has to go down to cultural settings, contextual cultural settings, which primarily is the family. So let's move on and talk about some models of how one might perceive this. And the first one on the screen is the two-factor model of emotion. The two-factor model of emotion has two issues. One, which makes total sense, is arousal. And that is, and they even mentioned this on the videos, that there is a physiological arousal. And you know, if you play video games, your heart starts to race, your blood pressure will go up if you take your blood pressure, your galvanic skin response, which is the sweat on your hands, increases, and you have a severe physiological response. This is not abnormal. In fact, it is normal. The non-normal part is how you internalize that response. And it's interesting because one of the things that I always talk to my students who are taking the GRE test, and I say, and we stress this in our lab, what I say is you're going to have physiological arousal before you go in to take the GRE test, the graduate record exam, to go on to graduate school. You are going to have an increased heart rate. Your blood pressure is going to go up. You're going to have sweaty palms. You can internalize that in many ways. You can internalize that as anxiety, which most students do, because test taking is anxious making. You can internalize that as fun and exciting. You can internalize it as an opportunity. And video games tend to get internalized as excitement, not anxiety. The interesting thing is there's pretty clear pretty clear research material that shows that when you look at the blood pressure and you look at the heart rate and you look at the galvanic skin response, that it lasts up to 4 to 9 minutes after the game is done being played. There's other research that even suggests that that's longer. There's some research that suggests that excitement, that physiological arousal can last up to 20 or 30 minutes after the game is played. And I think that's very important to pay attention to, because what that suggests is that the game is not encased in the actual playing of the game. The game is encased in everything that surrounds the game, which again is sort of a cultural way of looking at it. If you think of now about arousal and violent video games, what does that mean? You play a violent video game, and 4 to 9 minutes, maybe 20 minutes, 30 minutes, you're aroused. And if you believe that this arousal can be internalized as fun and exciting, then how do you then actualize that arousal? And in many cases, as I always used to like to joke, then you just go beat up your baby brother, because you've got to get rid of that feeling of arousal, and that's easy to do. Or you yell at somebody, or you hit somebody, or you lash out. There's the arousal model, also arousal part of the emotion model, suggests that there's desensitization. And what that means is that as you play the game more and more, the level of arousal starts to go down, but you like the level of arousal. It feels good, it's exciting. And so what you need to do is you need to play longer in order to get that same level of arousal. That's really an important point. We talked about the biochemistry of the brain, and we talked about the dopaminergic system with dopamine, serotonin, and other chemicals and hormones in there. That's really what's working here. That as you play, say you play a violent shooter game, a first-person shooter game, and you, in your first-person shooter game, you are very aroused and very excited when you first start playing it, and so you play for an hour, and then the next couple days you play for an hour, and an hour, and an hour, and then all of a sudden you realize you're not getting that same rush, that same feeling. So biochemically what's happening is you need to play longer in order to get that same kind of rush. So that's desensitization. Habituation is a little different. Habituation means, can we come back to me? Thanks. I like to see my face up there. Habituation means that over time, as repeated exposure to the game, it becomes more normal to you. It becomes less violent. It just becomes more normal. It doesn't mean your arousal level doesn't keep increasing or plateauing and increasing and plateauing and increasing as it does. What it means is that the same amount of violence doesn't have the same feeling, the same overall feeling that you've habituated to it. It's kind of like with me with chocolate. I used to be able to eat one piece of chocolate at night as a treat. Then after a while, I habituated to that, and I needed two, and then three, and then four, and then five, and then I was a chocoholic. When you habituate to it, the problem is that you have to do something with those feelings. And what do you have to do with them? Well, in general, what the research shows on the one side of the controversy is that you need to act out on it. The second part of the model is attribution. What do you attribute the emotion to? Or really, what is the cause of the arousal? And in general, young people are, because of the prefrontal cortex, that part up here, not really being developed until your 20s and maybe even your 30s, this is the part that does the attribution. This is the part that attributes the feeling of arousal, that feeling of arousal that you're getting, that galvanic skin response that you're getting, that heartbeat that attributes it to something. And what that does is you make a lot of misattribution. And so one of the theories in violent video games, and we'll talk about this when we talk about the general aggression model, one of the theories that's very strong in this area suggests that a lot of our problems is misattribution, that we don't attribute the feelings to just being in the game. The arousal is not just the game, but it's sort of generic arousal. And it's this sort of generic feeling that we have to get out. So the idea and the theory is that we then lash out. And when we lash out, we can lash out on a very local level, yell at your mom, hit your hand against a wall, throw something, get angry, get pissed off at your friend, hit your baby brother, whatever. Or it can be escalated and we can act out on a bigger level, which is then we start talking about school shootings. So this missed attribution is sort of a common issue in arousal, and that is that if your prefrontal cortex is not good enough at understanding where this arousal comes from, then you have what's considered unexplained arousal. And so you have to attribute it to something and you misattribute it to it. So again, there's increases the likelihood of aggression. So let me give you a sample study in how this is done. In general, what they do is they take, well, this is one model. So they take two games that are similar in appeal, and the way they measure appeal is they pretest them and ask how interested would you be in playing a game like this, but also similar in arousal. So they both make the same kind of arousal level, and they do the arousal based on usually heart rate and blood pressure. Galvanic skin response is a little harder to collect as a physiological response, but heart rate and blood pressure are pretty easy. But the two games differ in violence level. So what they've done is they've done these studies and they factor out the excitement level, how exciting the game is, and then they measure aggressive behavior. And this is interesting, it's called the noise blast task. You get to basically pick a level of noise, both how loud the noise is going to be and how long you're going to have that noise blast go on to give to your opponent in a game. Now, there's no real opponent there. This is based on the Milgram studies, which I'll talk about in a bit. There's really no opponent there, but it's a simulated opponent as though you're playing against somebody real. And the results show that playing a violent video game leads people to give longer and louder noise blasts, particularly if the participant, the player, has been blasted on the previous trial. So the idea is if the opponent has just blasted them, then they're going to blast even stronger back at you. So this is an interesting way of measuring this, of measuring how violent you can get. You're not really giving a real person a noise blast, although you think you are. They often show a Confederate in another room as playing against you, but you're giving a noise blast to a Confederate who's not really getting blasted at all, but it's the intent, it's the act. And if you've been just blasted, then you want to blast back harder and longer. Interesting paradigm. So here's an example of some more information about this.
Take a look at these photos of a woman and a man. Pick one, whichever you like, and on a scale from 1 to 10, rate how attractive you find him or her. Got your answer? Remember it. Now, buckle up. Well, that was a rush. By the way, that photo you picked earlier, how would you rate it now? If you find them more attractive, that's because studies show your brain is roused by a surge of adrenaline. Action leads to attraction, and we try to replicate that effect in your brain.
So, isn't that interesting that even your rating of attractiveness of somebody is impacted by your arousal level? We're just starting to understand this concept of arousal level and the role it plays, and it's really easy to do this in a video game context. So that leads us to what's called the general aggression model. This is an old model. It's almost 20 years old now, put out by Anderson and Bushman, who are big players in this area. You're going to meet the bigger players in this area, in this field. The general aggression model basically says that media violence effects occur through one of three arousal routes. This is how you get aroused. Either you get aroused through your thoughts, what's going on. We can bring it back to me for a second. You get aroused, what's going on in your head. Can we put the PowerPoint on the screen too so people can see this? Thanks. Get aroused for what's going on in your head. you can get aroused for affect from an affective or feeling point of view, or you can get aroused from a physiological point of view. So there are really three ways that arousal can happen in this general aggression model. Remember, arousal leads to aggression. That's the theme of the model. Arousal leads to aggression. And Anderson and Bushman came up with this idea, which is a complicated larger scale model that suggests that these three things, that thoughts, feelings, and bodily arousal, all three combine together. So now we'll go back to the screen. And violent video games influence all of these. Violent video games influence your thinking about what's going on. You think, I have to kill these people, I have to splatter them. It deals with your feelings about what's going on. You get a bodily arousal. And the interesting things is they influence each other. So when your thoughts are aggressive, that also changes your feelings to be more angry, which then increases your heart rate or increases your blood pressure or increases your galvanic skin response, depending upon the kind of arousal, or all three. So these feed into each other. This is what the model looks like. And I need to spend a little bit of time showing you. And if you look at the bottom, though, there are two things called, one's called proximal causes and one's called distal causes. These are proximal causes, which are temporary. These are short-term kind of causes. These are things that happen just momentarily or on the short term. Distal causes up here are more stable and long-term causes. So for example, the model starts up here with who you are biologically, what your environment is, and how both of these play a role in your personality. These are distal factors because they're stable and more long-term. Psychologists think your personality basically is formed and stays that way. And personalities don't change much. And the personalities come from nature and nurture. Remember the nature-nurture controversy? I'm sure you've learned that in a psych class, psych 1 class, I bet, somewhere. So these are your distal factors that then contribute to encounters. And they talk about the general aggression model in a social context. But you could also say that this is playing video games or anything else. And so your personality plays into who you are as a person, how you represent yourself, the people that are in the social context with you, and the situation that you're in. And that those then affect those three arousal states, your cognitions, your affects or feelings, or your bodily arousal, which then combine together to change your decision making. And remember, that's your prefrontal cortex that's doing that, which then your decision making leads to behavior, which leads all the way back again and feeds back considerably over and over and over again, but also feeds back into the environment, the social environment. So it changes your environment. So you can see the model's kind of complex, but really very simple. It's who you are, and then who are you meeting in a situation, and what happens inside of you that then causes you to behave. Behaviors in red showing that that's the bottom line, how you behave. So for example, if you have the kind of a certain kind of personality and you bump into somebody and they are in a situation, say you're walking along the street and somebody knocks into you. It's a social, somewhat social situation, although it's really not social. How does that affect your cognitions, your affect, your feelings, and your arousal? Well, you might think in your head, what an ignorant guy just bumped into me, wasn't looking where he was going. You might start to feel angry, and that might lead to sort of physiological arousal. And you go, hey, I'm going to go after him and tell him that he knocked into me, and you're going to go tell him he knocked into you, which then goes right back into a whole new situation. You may get into a fight with the person, but it all stems from what happens, and it really stems from the arousal. When you look at the proximal short-term causes and the distal long-term causes, on the left are a sample of proximal causes for the person and the situation. And if we go back, you'll see for the causes for the person and the situation and the proximal causes. And then on the right are the environmental modifiers and the biological modifiers. And if you go back, you notice biological and environmental modifiers go into your personality. So if you just take a look at this on the proximal or short term, there's scripts that we've talked about, aggressive scripts. There's your attitude toward violence, stereotypes that you have that you may carry with you, dehumanizing others. There's a lot of information about dehumanizing people coming from video game playing. Displacement of responsibility. If you bumped into somebody, you say it's his fault. Maybe you were weaving while you were looking at your phone. All of these are proximal causes, including your part of your personality characteristics, including narcissism, including your psychopathy, if you're psychopathic in any way, including impulse control, which is in your prefrontal cortex, including your self-image. Are you a tough, strong person? Your self-esteem level. Those are all parts of you. These are all parts of the proximal or temporary or short-term causes. But the situations also cause problems. There could be alcohol and drugs involved. You have a mood issue. You can read through these at your leisure, but you will see that these all together create a reason to be aggressive. And then on the long-term causes, the distal or long-term causes, there's cultural norms, which I mentioned is very important. There's life conditions, how your exposure to violent media is a very important one. Parenting, maladaptive parenting, living in a violent neighborhood, all of these kind feed into the environment. And then biological issues, ADD, ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, impulsivity problems, low serotonin, which is a chemical that makes you feel good, genetic factors, poor executive functioning, various hormones, all of these factors lead into this model. So how does this model, the GAM model, explain repeated exposure to media violence? So again, if you follow this through, you can see, let's start with recent or repeated media violence. So imagine that you've played a video game. What that leads to is increased aggressive cognitions, decreased empathy, anxiety to violent thoughts. So that's your affective part. What do they lead to? Well, first of all, you have to add in aggressive personality. So that adds into this problem. But what that leads to is hostile interpretations of a situation. He bumped into me on purpose. Aggressive options, I'm going to go confront him and push him so he can see what it feels like. Or you select aggressive options based on your feelings at the time. What those do is they lead into a retaliation with aggression, meaning you go and you push the guy. Sometimes rewarded, the guy goes, oh, I'm sorry, yeah, I didn't mean to bump into you. But it also might be provoking, which then the guy you bumped in, that you now pushed, gets upset, and the whole process starts again. So you can see how the model shows a pretty good explanation of how this whole system works. And it all basically feeds back into decision making. And that's really important to remember from when you're looking at all these models, that this all feeds back into how you decide how to act. So let's go back to my example of you're walking down the street, minding your own business, somebody bumps into you and walks fast past you. You invoke cognitions, you invoke feelings, you invoke arousal, bodily arousal. The bodily arousal is obvious. You get bodily aroused, you go, ah, what happened? You can feel your heart racing. You probably are leaking some chemicals like cortisol into your system to aid and abet that fight or flight reaction. Did the guy just bump into me on purpose? You have these cognitions running around your head. You have these feelings of anger, upset, and how dare him do that. And all of that feeds in together to making a decision. Now imagine that you're a teenager or a young adult and your prefrontal cortex is not really very adept at handling good decisions. You tend to make impulsive decisions, and so your impulsive decision is, I'm going after that guy and I'm going to push him back. So you can see how the general aggression model takes this whole concept of a violent confrontation into a violent act. Now, how does it take a violent video game or a violent media experience. And by the way, some of this research also talks about violent media experiences like violent television, violent movies. If you go to see a movie, I'm sure you notice this, if you go to see a very violent movie, you start to feel a visceral reaction. You start to feel, I mean, I describe it as kind of a tingling in my hands and my arms and my body. I feel like I'm not there in the violent situation, but I feel it viscerally. There's a visceral response to watching this violence. So it's the same as playing a violent video game or getting into a violent confrontation, which is why it's called the general aggression model. Back to the screen. So once a behavior's been executed, once you decide to go push the guy back, it starts back into a feedback loop that you saw back on the screen before. It starts back into a feedback loop down here where you're make a hostile interpretation, you generate more aggressive options, you pick those options, you retaliate back, it's the person retaliates to you, and it's this whole basically feedback loop, which then feeds into not only the next, into that behavioral occurrence, but also into what happens the next time. The general aggression model says that this is reinforcing over time, and so that the next time somebody bumps into you, you're going to remember what happened, and it's going to invoke that state even faster. So it's what's called cross-modality priming. I put that in capital letters so you'd pay attention to it. I should have underlined it, highlighted it, put it in red letters or something, because priming is very important. And let me talk about priming for a second here. Priming is an interesting concept. What priming means is it means it's your brain is preparing you for something. So for example, imagine that you're 14 years old and you like to play World of Warcraft or something, or some equally violent game. And you start thinking about, in school, you start thinking about you're going to be playing that game when you get home. Because mom and dad aren't home, you're a latchkey kid, you get to do whatever you want when you get home, you're gonna be playing that game. So now what happens is your cognition about playing the game is priming you to start getting aggressive, start getting aroused. It gets that arousal, and that arousal feeds into the aggression. So if you start thinking about it, say, just before recess, just before lunchtime, just before the end of school, you're likely to get into a fight, or you're likely to bully somebody else, or you're likely to be angry at somebody, or do something and act out aggressively because it's been primed. You haven't actually played the game, but you're priming it. This comes, by the way, from an old idea that when people used to pump water from underground, you've seen those movies where they have the pump where you pump like this. You have to pump a bunch of times before you get clean water. It's called priming the pump. That's a great test question, right? I think that's a good test question, priming the pump. But basically what priming then does is it starts to activate all of the arousal levels, your cognitions, your feelings, your bodily perceptions, your bodily physiology, and it starts to activate all of them all at once. So there have been some tests of this model along the way, and what I'm going to do is lead you through it, and we're going to stop pretty soon, a few minutes early today, because there's a good stopping point coming up. But what I'm going to do is give you a sample. This is one of the most well-researched areas in psychology, looking at aggression. So Doug Gentile is one of the researchers. He's at Iowa State. You'll see him later on one of the videos. He did a review of all the literature in 2005, and I'm going to give you some more up-to-date information too. And I think his quote at the end of the study is really a good summary of what he found. Evidence supports hypotheses that violent video game play is related to aggressive affect, aggressive feelings, physiological arousal, aggressive cognition, and then aggressive behaviors. Anderson and Bushman, Bushman are the ones who created the model. They did a literature review and looked at the paths that media violence might take in increasing aggressive behavior. And here's what they found. The black lines, you see the black lines here, are all well-established results in Anderson and Bushman's conclusions. The red lines, there's a couple here, are ones that they decided needed more study. Remember, this is 2018. This is not 2005, this is 2018. So Anderson and Bushman, Craig Anderson and I forget Bushman's first name, Neil maybe? I can't remember anymore. I just heard Craig Anderson talk recently. And basically, he's very firm on this, that the research supports that violence screen media use, and that's, he opens it up to anything on a screen, which means violent television, violent movies, all of these lead to aggressive cognitions, which lead to aggressive behavior, lead to aggressive affect feelings that lead to aggressive behavior, lead to desensitization to violence, which lead to aggressive behavior, and lead to a deficit in empathy, which lead to aggressive behavior. We'll talk a little bit about empathy next time. But there's two other sets of links that he says need more experience, more studies. One is that it leads to what he calls peer group shifts, meaning that you shift who you hang with, and that you start hanging with people who are more aggressive. And so you shift who you hang with, and that leads to more aggressive behavior. There's a few studies on that, more to come. And also, and this one's really important, leads to executive function or impulsivity deficits. And remember, that's from the prefrontal cortex, which then lead to aggressive behavior. So let's hear, Brad Bushman. Let's hear Brad Bushman talk, and then we'll come back.
Psychology professor Brad Bushman, a leading scholar in the field for several decades and the man behind the Ohio State research, says the effects are clearly measurable, and more so with the direct you-pull-the-trigger nature of newer 3D games.
You are linked to the violent character. If it's a first-person shooter game, you have the same visual perspective as the killer. You get points when you kill people. If you kill enough people, you get to advance to the next level of the game. You're also rewarded through things that you might hear. If you kill somebody, maybe you hear, "Impressive, nice shot, you are tied for the lead." And you hear these praise, and we know that reinforcement increases the probability of behavior. I think as these technologies...
How far is Bushman willing to go in terms of the predictive nature of his research?
The results clearly show that playing a violent video game increases aggressive behavior and also makes people numb to the pain and suffering of others. There is a link between exposure to violent media and violent criminal behavior. We can't do experimental studies. It's just a correlation. Correlation doesn't imply causation, but they're related.
There are so many important things that Bushman just said in a minute and 13 seconds. I don't want you to miss a couple of them. First of all, most of the research is correlational. Correlation does not imply causation. Just because two things go together does not mean that one causes the other. And that's really important. The other thing he said is that a lot of this can be attributed to reinforcement. Reinforcement means that you do an act, you get a consequence, that consequence is perceived as positive, and that then feeds back to have you do that act again. There's various kinds of reinforcement. They're all, in this case, all positive reinforcement we're talking about. Positive reinforcement can either be what's called continuous. This is great test questions, by the way. Excuse me. Positive reinforcement can be continuous, meaning every time you do something, you're reinforced, and so you want to do it again. Or it can be intermittent, meaning you're reinforced now, and then maybe you do it a bunch more times, and then you're reinforced, and then you do it once or twice, and then you're reinforced, and then you do it a bunch of times, and you're reinforced. Turns out that those two kinds of reinforcement, continuous and intermittent, are absolutely critical to understanding behavior. Continuous reinforcement is what you do to build up a behavior. If you want to get your kids to brush their teeth at night before they go to bed, then every time they brush their teeth, you give them positive reinforcement. What kind of positive reinforcement? Well, parents sometimes use point charts. They use words, "good job," "I'm proud of you." They use hugs. Doesn't matter what kind of positive reinforcement. If you reinforce some sort of act, some sort of behavior continuously every single time, that will build up that behavior over time. However, if you want to maintain the behavior, you then switch to reinforcing it intermittently. So imagine you were reinforcing brushing teeth every time, and now you decide to do it intermittently, so you don't give the kid a hug every night, but maybe every couple of nights, or every 3 nights, or 2 nights in a row, and then not for a few nights. That's going to maintain that behavior over the long run. So imagine now, put that in the context of video games. What are video games? Which kind of reinforcement? Continuous or intermittent? Video games are continuous reinforcement. You are continuously being reinforced. Every time you shoot at someone, bam, blood explodes. Every single time. Now, imagine certain kinds of video games are intermittent reinforcement, where they make it harder and harder. You go up the levels, the reinforcers get harder and harder to get, which is intermittent reinforcement. So now, can you understand why people keep playing video games where the levels get harder and harder? At the low levels, they're giving you constant reinforcement. Why are they doing that? So you win that level, you go up to the next level, and maybe there's almost constant reinforcement, but sometimes you aren't reinforced. Maybe sometimes you shoot and miss. Sometimes you only wing the dinosaur and blood doesn't spurt out. And but you do get that level. Then the next time you go up to the next level, now you're getting reinforced maybe every couple of times. And the intermittent reinforcements get less and less often, maintaining your behavior. This is, by the way, how slot machines work. This is how any kind of reinforcement works. If you want to get people to do something, continuously reinforce them, until you build up that behavior to a stable level, and then start intermittently reinforcing. Not taking away the reinforcements, just not doing it every time. Very powerful, and that's how video games work. So we're going to stop today. Next time we're going to come back, and what I'm going to give you next time is some more on this model, but a different twist on it. We're going to talk about some of the research that shows that maybe it's not so cut and dried as Anderson and Bushman talk about. Maybe video games don't really have that kind of effect. You heard a little bit of that on Laura Ingraham's show. You'll hear more from me on Thursday. And with that, I bid you good day.